Revelation 12:11, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. Welcome to By the Word of Their Testimony, and here is your host, Etienne McClintock.
Dear listener, greetings and a warm welcome. Thank you for joining us again on this program. I'm delighted to have your company, and today I have a very special guest all the way from California via Skype. And this is a young lady I met while we were traveling the Bible lands in 2017, and then was aware that she'd written a book about her life. And I'm telling you, you're in for something very special. This lady's got a remarkable testimony. And just up front, I just want to inoculate you and prepare you that her testimony actually delves into some very interesting subjects, and ones where we would suggest that if you have children listening, that it is parental guidance recommended. While it doesn't get explicit, it does have some adult content to it. So just to keep that in mind. But as you know, in the past, if you listened to this program before, you realize that it is a program where people just like you and me share their challenges, their trials, their opportunities, and the providences of God in their life, and how they have been impacted for good and for the glory of God, and how their lives have been changed. So I'd like to welcome my special guest all the way from California in the USA today. Her name is Susanne Vyhmeister. Now, Susanne, did I pronounce your name correctly?
You got it. It's Vyhmeister.
Vyhmeister. Wonderful.
Yes.
And it was lovely to meet you and your son while we were traveling through Jordan as well as Israel. And to just hear a little bit about your story. Now, you also have a book out there. What is your book called?
So my book is called Rebel Girl, The Fatherless Daughter. And it's available on Amazon, Kindle, and in print, and in the iTunes store. And one of these days, when I get over my cold, I'll be recording an audio book as well to go with it that will be sold on Amazon.
Okay, yes. So there's a number of opportunities for people to actually access your book and hear your story. And no doubt after they hear your testimony today, there'll be many people to hear the rest of the story that we don't have the ability to tell in about an hour or so.
You can also keep up with our family at vmeister.com. That also offers kind of the latest of what we're doing.
Because there's another book in the wings as well, from what I understand.
Yes, there is. Yes.
Okay, wonderful. Well, perhaps tell us a little bit about yourself and your family.
Well, I'm from Southern California. I was born on the East Coast of the United States. And then when I was just a wee baby, my mother moved us to Southern California. My father had passed away when my mother was only a few months pregnant with me. And that kind of would steer the rest of my life, because I often, even though I was adopted into a really loving family, I did always feel that missing piece of my, you know, father being gone. And I felt an absence in my life in the sense of a father. And so I grew up 60 miles east, so your listeners can picture where I was in Southern California. It's an area called the Inland Empire, and it's the birthplace of the Hell's Angels, and oftentimes it felt like the birthplace of methamphetamine, because there sure was a lot of it.
Is that right?
Yes, I grew up 60 miles east of Los Angeles in a little town called Cherry Valley. And I had pretty much, you know, an eventful childhood for the most part, until I started getting up into my teens. And you could really tell there that I was lacking a father, and because I started, you know, really craving male attention and dating fairly early at 12 and 13. I was very, interested in the opposite sex more so than the other girls in my class. I wanted to fill a void that I had in my life, and I was looking for whoever would take the place. And I guess I have to back up just a little bit, because my mother remarried, and this would be her third marriage at the time. And my mother struggled a lot with her own issues of abuse. And so a lot of the times when my parents, my adoptive father and my mother would fight and separate and then get back together, my mother would use me a lot as her marriage counselor. And so a lot of my book goes through this turbulent relationship I had with my mother, being kind of pulled into the family fights, because we were a blended family. So at sometimes there were six of us kids between half brothers, full brothers, step brothers, stepsister. And my mother confided in me a lot. And there was a particular incident when I was about 12 years old where, an uncle came over and they, were taking inappropriate pictures of me as a young 12-year-old girl. And I turned to my mother to kind of defend me for that, to tell her, I don't want to do these pictures. This is, I knew in my little heart that this was wrong. Mm. And at this time, our family, my mother had married a Seventh-day Adventist man, and she herself had grown up Seventh-day Adventist, but she had kind of left the church. And so up until I was about 12, we were in the Adventist church. And then my family left the Adventist church by the time I was 13. And so I would turn to my mother to kind of defend me in these situations. And I would find somebody whose, face would kind of gloss over. And she wouldn't defend me in these situations where you really need a mother to defend you.
Yes.
And stand up and do the appropriate thing. And so that was an extreme scar for many years that I was bitter at my mother for these things. And so then I turned to find in, other boys, men, what I was looking for in a family. And so thereafter, there was quite a few encounters with young men that were of a sexual nature, being as young as I was, and until I could find a steady boyfriend. And I ended up finding a boyfriend that was much older than I. And in between he and I's just absolutely, I don't know how to explain other than this roller coaster ride of a romance. At a young age of 15, I was sexually assaulted by a 25-year-old who was supposed to be picking me up for a Bible study. And, my mother, believing that I'm going to a Bible study, thought it was perfectly safe. And, but I was alone with a 25-year-old and sexually assaulted. And when I came home to talk to her, to tell her, this has happened, it was literally like her ears, like her whole body just shut down. She couldn't hear it, and she just walked away out of my room. And yet again, I just kept feeling like these knives to my heart were happening over and over. Mm. And so my whole book kind of chronicles from chapter to chapter, romantic relationship to romantic relationship to romantic relationship, and there's 36 chapters. And that's not even chronicling all of them. Clearly, I had a God-sized hole in my heart where that I was trying to fill. And, in 2010, I tried to write this testimony out, my testimony out in a book format before. And I wasn't willing to talk about this because I was still ashamed of all the men I'd had in my life. And I realized this book is the sanitized version, and it's not going to help anyone, because I had not yet realized that my incredible weaknesses and my points of shame we're going to be God's greatest tools for his glory. So, you know, my husband was the one, God love him, who sat down and edited every chapter, you know, my whole book. He put it together for me because he believed the story needed to be told. And I would come and I would bring to him some of these awful situations. And I would say, you know, should I put this in there? And he said, well, we can, you know, make it sound better, but you need to put it in there because there's going to be somebody else who's suffering with this same thing. Every time I found a rock bottom, I would dig down deeper and claw my way down deeper to another rock bottom. It just didn't seem like I was ever going to come up from the pit that I was in. Because I went from, you know, being relationship to relationship to relationship to where by the time I was, you know, 16 years old, I found myself pregnant at 16 with my first child. And I was not prepared for that, as you can imagine, any 16-year-old is not prepared to have a baby at six, or I actually delivered my baby at 17. And I had my first baby at 17, but thereafter, I was a single mom, single again, didn't want to be single, wanted to be in a relationship, wanted to find another guy to fill the hole that was in my life. And instead I found methamphetamine. And as I had mentioned earlier on, my father had died. He died of a medical malpractice suit. The doctor that came to operate on him was drunk on New Year's Eve. Whoa. And so when I was 18 years old, I got a $20,000 check. And this was as I was a drug addict on crystal meth and cocaine and any other drug that I could get my hands on. And so you hand somebody a $20,000 check at that stage of life, and it catapulted me from a lowly drug user on the street to being a drug dealer and dealing with some pretty nasty characters, pretty dangerous people. So by this time, I was bitter at my mom. I was bitter at God. I started to really get into the occult, and I was craving a spiritual experience, but I had all this hatred in my heart, and my mom was going through another divorce. And at the time, and the father that I'd been raised with, he had left and hadn't had any contact with him. And it just seemed like my life was kind of falling apart. So I plunged quite deeply into satanic rituals. I never got into the organized satanic church, but I was praying to demons on my own. And I would have people over to my house who were known warlocks, witches, people, you know, with pentagrams tattooed on them, and people that worship Satan and were quite heavily steeped into that, and still are for the most part. Most of the people that I was associating with back then are still steeped heavily in the occult. And you know, around this time, those things, you get into it a little bit and you think you can just get in a little bit, and you just go down this dark tunnel, and it just seems like a vortex that sucks you in. And I was, before I knew it, I was ripping Bibles apart and found myself possessed one night, playing a guitar. I don't play guitar, and did a blues performance, and I have no, I don't play. And, you know, I kind of woke up out of this trance with, you know, blood all over the fretboard and blood on me from my fingers, bleeding from playing the guitar because I wasn't used to it.
Wow.
And, you know, I knew what had happened. I knew that I had been possessed and I felt a strange power. And I thought, you know, this is a power that I can use. I was so angry at everything around me that I knew this power now that I had was something that I wanted. Being a drug dealer, people enjoy being drug dealers often because, you know, not only are you making money, but you are the one in power. Mm. You are the one holding, you know, the purse strings, so to speak. So I felt that so many different times, been with sexual abuse and sexual assault, that I'd had my power ripped from me. It was kind of seemed like a natural flow of things as to take it back through spiritualism and the occult. And my anger became so uncontrollable that grown men started to fear me because I was so unpredictable at parties. I was starting fights. I'd walk up to people and just clock them in the face. I would fight other men. It's strange. I didn't fight females. I wanted to fight the men. And I really was looking always for an outlet for that anger. Mm. And so by this time, I was so high on methamphetamines all the time that, you know, on one particular occasion, another girl in my town was talking bad about me, and I broke into her house at night, home invasion, pulled her out of bed by her hair, and, you know, pulled her out to her living room and held a knife to her throat and said, you know, are you, you know, and not very nice language, sure. You know, basically told her, if I catch you talking about me again, there's going to be consequences. And that was the level of anger that I had.
Mm.
And it wasn't too long after that that rumors started to go around the town about me that, you know, I was a killer. And later on, it would be assumed that I was a hit woman. And it was because of my out of control anger. And I just want to highlight how bitterness and hatred and a lack of forgiveness manifests itself in this anger. And the more angry a person is, you know, I can guarantee 100% the more hurting a person is, the more unresolved violations they have. I detail in my book that bitterness is an unresolved violation of someone's justice system.
Mm.
Because and it's my own personal belief that God's, our strongest human emotion is not love, but justice. Because, you know, love may not always get be the rallying cry at a demonstration, but justice will get a lot of people together fighting for a cause. And I think that's because fundamentally God and he, you know, we have the mercy seat, the picture of God's justice and his mercy. And that combined creates a loving father. And, you know, bitterness, I believe, is somebody who has had hurts and things done wrong. You know, they've been definitely wronged, but they cannot forgive. They've been violated in some way, and they don't take it and lay it at the cross. They you know, say, God, why did you let this happen to me? How could you? And, or, you know, what this person did to me, that was wrong. And, you know, I'll get into a little bit later, the process to resolve that. So here I am, a drug dealer, and, you know, all in the occult, and I get pregnant again at 19. the definition of stupidity is doing the same thing over and over, expecting different results.
Sure.
So I felt stupid for getting, I felt ashamed. I felt, you know, that you can have one maybe teen pregnancy, but to have another baby, I just couldn't imagine doing that again.
So even though you had all this power, you had this incredible reputation, which is obviously a far greater reputation than your actions actually portrayed. I mean, you were known as a hit woman, but you never killed anybody. And
no.
Also with the drugs and also with your involvement in the occult, there was still a sense of shame, even though you felt that you could do whatever you wanted. Incredible.
Deep on everyone's heart is written, I believe, the law of God. And we know what's right and what's wrong. That's why even in prison, you can still appeal to quite a few people, even in prison, on the basis of what's right and what's wrong. Because they have a very strong code of respect amongst criminals. You know, they'll steal from you. They'll sell drugs to your children. But you disrespect them, and they're outraged. At least that's my experience.
Sure. So there's still a code of right and wrong even amongst hardened criminals, is what you're saying.
Yes. Mm. Mm-hmm.
And, of course, it reminds me of that text in the Gospel of John, John chapter 1, where it talks about Christ being the light that lights every man that comes into the world. So it's obviously it's the Holy Spirit that convicts people of right and wrong. And we should never give up on people. Although we might see a hardened exterior, we never know what's happening in the mind and how the Holy Spirit is working in their lives as well. And your testimony is a wonderful testament to that fact.
Yeah, you know, there was a lot of people that believed I was the last person to become a Christian. You know, most people thought I was a lost cause because, you know, I had a Christian come on, a classmate, an old classmate of mine, who became a Christian. He came to visit me up at my house where I was living, and I chased him off off my property and threatened his life because I hated Christians so much. You know, I was controlled completely by Satan at this point. But I've got to tell you, there was, you know, the Bible says that God is the father to the fatherless. And I felt a strong, even though I was cutting myself, I was, you know, ripping pages out of the Bible. I mean, any Bible I came across, you know, I would use it for, to roll my tobacco in. I still felt a strong presence of the Holy Spirit trying to pull me back. And I fought against it so much that I would say, you know, you need to leave me alone. And I would give my life over to Satan. I would say, I want nothing to do with you, and, you know, tucking into the Holy Spirit and then pledge my allegiance, to evil. But I felt, you know, it never went away. I always felt a presence of the Lord following after me. And I do believe that even though my mother was struggling with a lot of her problems and was very abusive also of me, she had a lot of bitterness herself that she would take out on me. She was kind of the source of a lot of the struggles that I was having because of the hurt and the pain. But she was praying for me. And I do believe that makes a huge difference. I tell parents all the time, you know, I have an 18-year-old son now, and you cannot stop praying for your children because you have no idea the power that that's giving God in their lives.
Amen.
And even though I was really far down the road, as most people would see me, into the occult, you know, the Lord was chasing after me. And so, you know, here I am pregnant again. And this was a real opportunity in my life to start turning to the Lord because I did feel shame. I realized I'm high on drugs. I told myself that you know, I've done so many drugs. This baby's probably not even normal. And my mother said, you can't have another baby in my house.
Were you living at home from the time you had your first baby to the second? So you're still at home?
No, I was in and out of the house.
Okay.
And then even then I would live in hotel rooms sometimes. You know, the life of a drug addict.
Mm.
But by this time I returned home because my mother was going through a divorce. And so I kind of saw her house as a free-for-all because there was no one ever home. My mom was gone all the time working, and she was not home. So I kind of had a free house to just run drugs and all kinds of manner of evil out of. I started to kind of pull back from the drugs a little bit around getting pregnant the second time. But my mother had made an appointment for me to get an abortion, and I really didn't want to get an abortion. I didn't want to not have a place to live again, because I had been, you know, worried, been housing insecure, I would say. But by this time later on, I would find myself homeless.
Mm.
But by this time, I was, you know, I had struggled before with places to live, and I didn't want to not have a place to live, especially because, I had a 2-year-old son. And so, I went ahead and got the abortion, and that was a huge turning point in my life because, I was self-destructive. Like I said, I would dig through rock bottom to much as low as I could get. And when you thought I couldn't go any deeper into the pit, I would just dig down deeper to another rock bottom, because after I had an abortion, the cutting, I couldn't stop it. I was a self-mutilator.
Mm.
And a lot of people will ask, a lot of it was in ceremony with the occult. But at the same time, it had become an addiction. And people will ask me, because their daughters or their sons cut, why do people cut themselves? They don't understand it. And one reason is it feels good to watch yourself heal. You can't heal your heart, but you can cut yourself and watch your arm heal.
Wow.
And then it's also a way to have a release. You have you have pain, and then you just have this release. And I think there's a certain amount of a dopamine rush even when you cut yourself, because it's a way to tell yourself you're still alive. But be sure, I believe that anyone who has a fascination with death and cutting themselves, there's a demonic element to it.
Mm.
Because we know from the biblical account of the demoniac at the Gadarenes,
nice.
the Baal worshippers on top of Mount Carmel, that they're, this is a satanic practice.
Mm.
And so even though people, who have, it's a psychiatric condition now, it is definitely, I believe firmly, that it is there's a demonic component with it, because a fascination with death, you know, Christ is life. He's light, and he represents life. He comes to bring us life and bring it more abundantly. And Satan brings us death and the fascination with death.
Yeah.
So, I start going, I wanted to get off of methamphetamines because I felt that I had used it basically as an excuse to have an abortion. So I got off methamphetamines.
So, Susanne, what we're going to do is we're just going to take a quick break there. Your story is absolutely fascinating, and I almost don't want to interrupt your story because it's such a fascinating story, but we're just going to take a quick break.
Okay.
Dear listener, we are with Susanne Vyhmeister, who wrote the book called Rebel Girl, The Fatherless Daughter, and we're listening to her testimony at the moment, and I have to tell you, I am speechless just listening to this testimony. I can't wait to hear the second part of it, but we're just going to take a short break, and we'll be right back after this message, so stay tuned.
Decision time. The steps involved in making a decision are this. What you think causes your feeling. The way you feel determines the way you act. If you have stinking thinking, it leads to negative feelings. Negative feelings lead to negative behaviour. In Proverbs 23:7, it says, "For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he." Maybe it's time to have a checkup from the neck up.
Dear listener, welcome back to By the Word of Their Testimony, and I have with me via Skype from California, USA, Susanne Vyhmeister, who's written the book Rebel Girl, The Fatherless Daughter, which tells her life story. And if you were there for the first half of the program so far, I'm sure you're as fascinated and spellbound by her story as I have been listening to it. Now, just before the break, Susanne, you were telling us about how you got into more self-harm after you had aborted your second pregnancy and how you felt there was a demonic connection to that.
Yes. And then, I was talking about how because I had an abortion, I felt that I'd used my methamphetamine use and all the other drugs I was taking at the time as an excuse to have an abortion. I decided to get myself clean off of drugs, but I did it on my own in my own room. I kind of shake, rattled, and rolled through the withdrawals, which was not pretty and it was not fun, but I did it by myself. But because I had no support system, and because I had no faith other than, you know, faith in the occult, I replaced one drug with another drug. I plunged deep into alcoholism, and I used alcohol as another way to numb. That was legal. Well, not legal for me because I was underage in the United States. The legal drinking age is 21, and I was 20 now. And I was drinking so heavily that I was waking up in the morning with Jack Daniels and, drunk by noon. So it wasn't any surprise when I got into a huge car accident. I was dealing marijuana at the time, and I had just gone to make a drug deal, and I had a large quantity of marijuana in my back seat, and I was listening to some really, you know, hip hop music, rap, and I was feeling very strong, and I feeling very invincible, and I went to make a left turn right into a car that was going 60 miles an hour, truck, and it just barreled right into the side of me and cracked my car in half. So, and I had a friend with me, and when I came to, I was knocked unconscious at the scene, and my drug dealer heard the crash, the loud crash that was heard for a mile away. The sound, people came out of their apartments down there. It was quite a loud noise.
So
I'm told.
Quite a big accident and one at high speed as well.
My drug dealer comes out and he pulled all the marijuana, you know, as drug dealers do. He pushed my unconscious body aside to get the drugs so that he wouldn't be incriminated when the police came. And they came. But when I came to, my friend was passed out and I thought I'd killed her. And I felt just guilt just flooded me at a moment of sobriety coming to. And I just thought to myself, what am I doing? And the police came and I was arrested. And I got in the back of that cop car, and the police officer could have taken me to prison that night, and I would have been in prison for a long time. But I begged him. I said, please, I have a son. He's 3 years old. I'm supposed to pick him up. If I lose custody of him, if I lose my visitation rights with him, I'll never see him again. Please, you know, don't send me to prison. Can you just book and release me so that I can at least, you know, not go to prison and keep my visitation rights with my son. And the police officer looked in the back seat at me, and, you know, I had mascara dripping down my face, and I looked a mess, and I stunk. And I was taken to the police station. He took me to the police station and booked and released me that night.
Wow.
But I was chained, you know, there to this pole in the police station waiting for a ride to come and get me. You have some moments to think. And I started really, you know, pondering back on my life, thinking, you know, what am I doing? I'm wasting my life on these things. So those were the first thoughts I started having of what am I doing with my life? Why do I keep getting in trouble? But I wasn't done yet, because, like I said, I just keep going back down deeper. I went and I got a job at a known biker gang bar, and I got pretty steeped into the criminal biker gang culture. But there was a young, I wouldn't say he was young. He was about, I don't know, late 40s, maybe early 50s. But this guy at the biker bar, we call him Jack in the book, but he kind of took me under his wing as a little sister, and kept me from getting in more trouble than I could have gotten in. You know, I could have gotten into a lot more trouble than I did. But he told me a story one night on how he saw a demonic angel, and he put the question to me, you know, why do you mess around with the occult like you do? And I had a lot of Bible prophecy, Bible studies from Doug Batchelor and Amazing Facts and, you know, a lot of those types of Bible studies when I was a young girl.
Mm. So and this is now ran up to the age of 12 that you had all that exposure?
Yes. And so he was asking me questions about, you know, this demonic angel that he had seen, this interaction. It had kind of sobered him up in his life. He was on the run from the law at the time, and he was also into drugs and alcohol, but he had this experience where he looked evil in the eye, and he really pulled back from a lot of the criminal element that he was involved in. Now, he didn't get out of the biker gang at the time, but he pulled back out of the alcohol and the drug abuse that he was involved in. And so having these conversations with him, I wanted to answer some of his questions because I knew there were answers. I was raised an Adventist, but I had forgotten a lot of it.
Mm.
And so, and then he started questioning me, why are you in the occult? You know, why, if you know these things, how come you're not following them? And, he also, you know, was the first one to tell me, you have a drinking problem.
Right.
And I said, no, I don't. What do you mean? I don't have a drinking problem. And he's like, girl, you got a drinking problem. And so, you know, there was one night where he saved me from a major motorcycle accident because he knew the driver of the motorcycle was inebriated, and he pulled me off the back of a bike just 5 minutes, you know, just a few minutes before it. This guy had a major crash. So I kind of, you know, during this whole time, what I haven't mentioned in the testimony is pretty much every stage of this life, there's a boyfriend involved. Mm-hmm. That's what my life always revolved around. So around this time, I had been in and out of the Hollywood club scene before, but I met a man who was a Hollywood club promoter. He worked with, you know, famous bands and quite a few famous venues in the punk rock scene, blues scene. I was heavily into the goth scene, and I started dating him. And once we got together, it was like gasoline and fire. My alcoholism just exploded. We were major partiers. We would wake up and not have any recollection how we got where we got. Mm. So, you know, he was not the best for me. And I ended up, you know, getting together with him and quitting my job at the biker bar. Now, the one positive about working at the biker bar was I had my own money. And when I was with, you know, my new boyfriend from Hollywood, I was dependent on him for money. And so I started to feel very trapped. And then I broke up with him, And I moved to another city that was a neighboring city. I was happy to get away because by this time I had really established myself as a very angry person. People were afraid of me. And I was living in Redlands, and I was date raped. Somebody drugged my drink. I at the time, I was really trying to go to AA. It always seemed to, as soon as I took a couple steps forward in my life, something would come and just knock me down again. And that something was Satan. Satan didn't want to lose me. He's quite an effective soldier in his army. So I was at a party, and somebody, you know, put something in my drink. And because of my major drug use, I woke up multiple times during the assault, and which surprised him. And when I woke up in the morning, I knew, you know, I obviously I had some memories from the night before. And I never met this guy before. I mean, I had never had an interaction. I had seen him at his place of work. He worked at a grocery store, and I had just had, you know, brief seconds walking past him, but I had, you know, no talking with him, and I failed to report it. I did not report it. I should have called the police at that time, but I figured I was pretty much, in my own estimation, no better than an unpaid prostitute. So why would anyone listen to me? I was really afraid of the reporting process, and I literally just stuffed it down. And I immediately went back to my old boyfriend from Hollywood, because I felt that, well, at least if I have a boyfriend, even if he's not good for me and we're really bad for each other, at least I'm protected. Because this may not have happened to me if I had been protected.
So you sort of picked the best out of the worst bunch of options, basically.
Exactly. It's better the devil you know than the devil you don't. You know? So that was my thinking at the time. But I go back to him, and the relationship just gets worse, and there's infidelities. And, you know, I get a call one night, and my boyfriend and I had gotten this huge fight. He had thrown things at me, goes tearing out of the driveway in his truck, and I know he's off with some other girl. And I didn't want to believe it, but I had a feeling. But if my feelings were confirmed at 2 or 3 in the morning, when I get a phone call from my friend who's at the bar, and she sees my boyfriend with another girl, and they're together and making it quite clear to everyone around that they are, you know, dating together. And so I felt absolutely betrayed. And I thought, you know, I couldn't even count by this time how many men I'd been with. And I felt dirty. I felt ashamed. I felt like every time I try to get my life together, everything just falls apart. I tried to go to school more than once by this time. And every time I'd go, I'd end up go to college. I'd end up dropping out because I'd have some trouble with some awful car I was using at the time. And so, or some circumstance would just, my life was always falling apart. That's just how it was. And that's kind of the story of most alcoholics that you talk to. And that was my life. And I felt ashamed. I was filled with shame, but I was also filled with a lot of anger. I was very angry at all the things that had happened to me, the numerous sexual assaults. And you know, I was angry. I didn't have a family. I wanted a father. I didn't have a father. I was so jealous of friends that I saw that had this relationship with their father. And that's all I wanted. And I was more interested in the friendship part of relationships with the men that I would, you know, date than I was even the sexual part. I just wanted that connection with a man. And so that night when I find out my, you know, however many boyfriend by this time was cheating on me, I took a bottle of moonshine that I knew was brewed in Alaska, and it was very potent stuff. And I just started drinking, and I went out to the sky, and I put my fist up in the air, And I said, all right. I screamed into the sky. I said, that's it. You know, if you want me, you come and get me. You get me out of here. You get me away from my boyfriend, and you get me out of here. If you get me out of here, I'll be yours. And it wasn't but a few hours later that I was out of there. And it was a miraculous circumstance that came together to get me completely out of there in a place to live where I wasn't homeless or couch surfing. And I go through some of those details in my book because sure. There's a lot I'm skipping here, but,
understand.
So I go to dry out I go home to my mom's house, and I go through alcohol withdrawal, and, I want to really highlight this story because it's so important. I was not yet a Christian. I was kind of, interested in Christianity. I was starting to pick up some books that had to do with Christianity, but I wasn't ready yet to dedicate my life. I was still struggling with, smoking, and I was really still struggling with bitterness, and I was angry still. But I was trying. I was really trying to pull my life together and not date anyone, not to stay single, which is really hard to do when that's what you've done your whole life for, this is 22 years now.
And were you still practicing self-harm at this time?
No, I was not. By this time, I was really ashamed of the marks on my arms. And I start getting off of alcohol, and one day my mother's new husband came to me and told me that my mother was suspicious of me having an affair with my stepfather. And that just crushed me because those were the kind of issues that I had dealt with my mother with before. She was very, because of the abuse that she had experienced, she was very suspicious of incest, even when there was none, because there was some, issues in her own family I won't go into, but, that crushed me. It really hurt me because, that wasn't even on my radar. I just wanted a father, and I was looking at this new stepfather as, maybe you could be my father.
Yes.
And so to have that dirty, thing suggested to me, I told myself, you know what? The reason why you don't have a father is because you don't deserve a father. You bring this out in every man that you meet. And so I went running down my street, the tears were just, flying off my face as I ran. And I just ran so fast. I think I ran over a mile, and I found a ditch, and I literally threw myself into the dirt in the ditch. And I cried out again. And I said, all I want is a father. I just want a father. And why can't I have a father? And I was so angry. And then I get up and I start to walk home, and, I meet somebody who I used to provide drugs to. He knew me as a big drug dealer, and so he's like, come party with me. Well, I was at the lowest of the lowest point I had been at in a long time, and I had been trying so hard to stay sober. And I follow him home, and that night I did methamphetamine, cocaine, huffed paint, drank Jack Daniels, smoked marijuana. I was trying to kill myself. I was trying to overdose. And I somehow woke up in my bed. I wasn't even sure how I got home. And I could feel my heart stressing to beat. I knew I had done a lot of drugs that evening. And I thought, I've got to stop this. The next time I do something like this, I'm not going to wake up. And I regretted my decision to, my decision to try to overdose. And I felt the Holy Spirit say, get up. And I got up, and I felt the Holy Spirit impress me to go to my mother's bookshelf. And I went to my mother's bookshelf, and my eyes fell on The Desire of Ages. And I just heard the Holy Spirit say to me that that's what you need. And I thought, surely I cannot read this right now. I literally just woke up from a night of binge drinking drugs and alcohol. You know, God does not want me right now. Mm. And I can't stress enough that it's the things that we struggle with, and the things that, you know, we are fighting against, that God will use ultimately as our testimony later, and to demonstrate his power.
Mm.
And,
amen.
So I pulled that book out of the shelf, and I opened it, and I started reading it. And for the first time in my life, the pain in my heart was gone. When I would open that book, it would be the only time I didn't feel this tremendous emotional pain, and that's because I was encountering the person of Jesus, and I was encountering, you know, a loving person, a loving God, and I was meeting my Father for the very first time. And so the ache in my heart started to go away. And that's one of my favorite chapters that I love to talk about, is the story that Christ, when Jesus meets the man at the pool of Bethesda, because I've talked to physicians, and we've agreed that we believe that that man had something like syphilis. He had something where everyone knew, you know, all the mess ups that he had made, the wild life he'd had, and that he had brought his sin on himself. And that was me. I had brought my problems on myself. I was angry at everyone else, but really, I was doing this to myself. I was hating other people. I was so angry at the men who had failed me, assaulted me, you know, abused me or abandoned me, that I was, it's just like drinking poison and expecting the other person to die. That hatred was killing me. It wasn't killing them. It wasn't hurting them. It was killing me. And the more I hated, the more, the worse I got. And I love the chapter, the story of the pool, man at the pool of Bethesda, because, he was as needy could be. He couldn't walk. He was about to die, and he was really discouraged. And Christ looks down, and I love where the Desire of Ages says that Jesus didn't ask the man to exercise any faith in him, like Jesus often asked others to, do you believe in me? He didn't ask this man to exercise any kind of faith in him, because this man, he knew he was wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked.
Mm.
And he knew his need. And you know, Desire of Ages also says that if we understand our need, there's nothing that Christ can't do with us. There's no miracle he can't, there's no miracle he won't do. There's no power he'll withhold from us if we understand our desperate need for Christ. And so he heals the man. Not only does he heal the man, but it says that he was one of the worst cases in Israel, but he uses this worst case to go publish. It's the book uses the word publish the truth of the Sabbath. This man is just saying he's been healed on the Sabbath throughout Jerusalem. And this is who Christ used. And it's so encouraging to me, because it's often our weaknesses that are our greatest resources. People think, I can't be involved in ministry. I can't witness to this person. I was just angry at my husband last night, or I just did this, you know, yesterday. You know, I can't stress to you the strength that can be manifested through us when in our weaknesses. It's our weakness that reveals the greatest power in the universe. And that's the power of Christ. He says he gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, he increases strength. That's Isaiah 40:29. And, you know, Paul, of course, 2 Corinthians 12:10 says, you know, for when I am weak, then I am strong. And I started this interview saying in 2010, I tried to write my story, and I'm glad I didn't write it then, because I was not willing to share the shame of numerous sexual relationships, substance abuse, sexual assault, you know, these are subjects, and you don't, they're kind of taboo. People don't want to hear about it. It's a little uncomfortable. But I was not willing at that time to talk about it because I wasn't willing to be vulnerable.
Mm.
But I've realized that it's the places where I'm vulnerable, where Christ will use it to witness to others. And that's where other people are vulnerable too. And I want to share one more verse because I want to encourage anyone who's listening that it's going to be the thing that you struggle with the most. When Christ gives you victory, that he's going to call you to share the most and where you will do the most good. And it's amazing to see God take, like the scars on my arms. I have lots of scars from self-harm and from the occult. And, you know, I have reminders from the nights when I was, you know, giving my blood to Satan and satanic rituals.
Mm.
But those are the scars I've been able to show my children, where my father would not let the enemy tear me apart, where he fought for me.
Mm,
he pulled me from this. He pulled me out of it, and he saved my life. And I can show my children, look, this is tangible evidence where Satan tried to kill me, but my father came and saved me. And that I would like to share 2 Corinthians 1, verses 3 through 4. It says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may then be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by.
Mm.
It's going to be, our testimony is going to be how the things that we've suffered. And something I'm learning, I have a chronic illness I was born with. And something that I've learned is that it's often the things that cause us the most pain that Christ is able to use the most. Mm. And that's my theme, is that my incredible weaknesses are God's greatest tools for his glory.
Look, we thank you so much, Susanne, for sharing your testimony with us today. We've out of time, unfortunately. I'd love to hear so much more, and maybe we'll have to do another program at another stage. But if people want to hear the rest of your testimony, they can actually buy the book that you have written, and it's available on Amazon. It's available on iTunes, I think you mentioned, and it's also available on hardcover. And the book is called Rebel Girl, The Fatherless Daughter. So Susanne, joining me from all the way from California today via Skype, I just want to thank you for your time. And I pray God will continue to bless you as you witness for him and minister to others in regards to what God has done for you. And also for those who find themselves in desperate situations, maybe they're angry, maybe they're disappointed and people have let them down, and they may feel that anger that you mentioned as well, that even in those circumstances, God is able to transform and change their life. Because I can say when I met you, there was nothing intimidating about you. However, if I'd met you probably 10 or 15 years earlier, I might have been very intimidated by you because you had such a great reputation and a scary reputation at that. So Susanne, thank you very much. We pray that God will continue to bless you. And we hope that we can chat with you again sometime here on 3ABN Australia Radio. Dear listener, thank you for joining us today. We pray that God will continue to bless you. And if you would like to hear more information about her book, or you couldn't get all those details down, please give us a call or send us a message via email. Thank you. God bless.
You've been listening to a production of 3ABN Australia Radio.